Welcome everyone to this online version of Sustainable Roundtable with the Japan Times. Our guest today is Monica Nagashima, and Monica is the country manager of InfluenceMap, which I think is an absolutely amazing organization. So I was really excited to be able to have the opportunity to talk with Monica today. And I hope we can explore a little bit about InfluenceMap, but also obviously, as is always the main theme in these roundtables, finding out a little bit more about her motivations and her journey to get to where she is today. So welcome, Monica.
Hello. Yeah, great to be here. Thank you so much for this invitation.
Thank you. Let's just kick off with a little bit of perhaps a size and scope on InfluenceMap. Can you give us a little bit of a background of the organization, what it is doing around the globe, and what it's doing in Japan, and anything specific that's going on in Japan, perhaps that may be unique or different than what's going on in other parts of the world?
Yeah, absolutely. So InfluenceMap is an independent nonprofit climate risk think tank founded in 2015 in London. Now we're a pretty, I think, a global organization with offices in the US, Japan, and Korea, and in Australia. And we have a couple of programs. So one of them is called Lobby Map, where we look at how companies lobby or influence policy, climate change policy or clean energy policy. Then we also have a program called Finance Map, where we look at the financial sector from different climate perspectives. So in Japan, we are kind of mostly looking at how the companies are influencing policy. And we work very closely with the Climate Action 100 Plus Investor Network. So actually InfluenceMap is a technical advisor, and there are a number of metrics that we feed to investors and to help them kind of, and they use it in their engagements, which, you know, kind of range from conversations to, in some cases, even shareholder resolutions. So last year, for instance, there was the first resolution filed against a Japanese company, specifically around their public policy engagement. So, this, I think, maybe in the sustainability or in the climate space, policy engagement might seem like a new subject, but it is very important, and investors are certainly paying close attention, and kind of the conversations are picking up even here in Japan.
So I assume that when the organization was established, that there was a recognition of a need to provide, well, there were, the pain point was probably that there was a perception that, or a reality that companies were, or corporates were in fact influencing the policy process in a way that needed to be a little bit more transparent. Would that be a good way of summing up perhaps the original concept behind the organization?
Yes, absolutely. And I think it really came from an investor need for this type of information. They could see the company's stated plans, their maybe CO2 emission reduction goals, and sort of internal operations. But there's an understanding that without policy change, it'll be really hard for these companies to get to net zero. And then, very importantly, the companies have an influence over these policies. So when, obviously, politicians, they do want to listen to the voices of the business sector and the economic sector, and when they hear opposition to a proposed policy, that is going to delay it. And this sort of corporate responsibility on policy has been brought up as a major issue in kind of various IPCC reports and thought leaders, but InfluenceMap was probably the first organization that kind of sort of systemically started studying this issue and has created a process of cataloging, scoring, and basically systematizing how an assessment of how companies are influencing climate policy.
I find it such a compelling mission. I mean, when you think of corporates in, I guess, a rather superficial way, you think about what their statements are about what they're trying to do, whether there is any greenwashing going on. And so it's really much to do with the visible parts of their disclosures and their actions. And yet, below the surface, there is obviously another layer, which is how they are seeking to influence that policy and the impact of those activities on, as you said, for instance, impressing politicians that they should delay policy decisions or take them in a different direction. So I think it's a really, really compelling mission that that InfluenceMap has. Amazing organization.
Yeah, thank you. But It really is, you know, we're hoping to, I think maybe especially in Asia and in Japan, the lobbying is, you know, can be seen as a sort of, you know, a taboo subject. But, you know, climate like policy advocacy is something that a lot of companies are actually doing already. They might not realize it. For instance, the biggest, most important thing is probably industry associations. So any company that belongs to a third party or an industry group has to be aware of what that group is advocating, especially if it's a group that has lots of different sectors. So we call them cross sector business groups. They tend to take the lowest common denominator positions. So they will be more negative and kind of more oppositional climate policy than a lot of its, you know, other members. So especially for a company that has these ambitious targets for themselves and is really trying to push the green agenda, and investors are demanding this too, they have to also look at their industry associations and make sure that they are representing the company's views. And, you know, part of this is kind of disclosure, is looking into the activities of these groups, and then also for the company themselves to kind of be aware of what their public affairs teams or what their communication teams are putting out there, and making sure that all of this is consistent with their own practices and also climate science.
Your point on the industry associations is really interesting, and I'd like to come to it a little bit later as well in a little bit more depth. But you know, the point you raise is interesting, because you may have a company who on an individual basis does actually have some very high objectives and high aims, but they are part of an industry association that is pitching, as you said, at the lowest common denominator. And so there's always going to be a gap there. And it faces them with the, I guess, conundrum of they need to be part of an industry association for certain reasons, and yet that industry association may not be aligned with the same sort of targets or the same activities that they're doing. So that's a really interesting dilemma that I think is emerging. So let's dig into that a little bit later. But first of all, it'd be interesting to know a little bit about your journey to becoming the country manager of InfluenceMap in Japan. I understand that you are Japanese-Ukrainian, so you have a great connection with Japan, obviously, and that you originally majored in biology and chemistry.
Yes. So I guess growing up, I have been very interested, you know, in nature preservation. Kind of grew up in a in the suburbs of Kiev, and we had cherry trees and apple trees, and our neighbors kept goats, so it was all very idyllic. But I guess I never really thought of specifically working in this field. So in university, yes, I majored in biology and chemistry, but also I guess I was lucky in that our program was multidisciplinary. So I also got to take classes in a lot of other subject areas. And kind of through that, I ended up in the US on a Department of State program that had us do, so it was called, I think, the Study of US Institutes on Environmental Leadership. And they brought in students from 5 different countries, and we spent 5 weeks traveling through really beautiful natural areas, Hawaii and Colorado, trying to come up with some business plans for how to preserve this nature, but also kind of help them succeed as a business. And I think through that, it really kind of hit me that you know, these natural, beautiful landscapes are in danger, but no one is out there specifically trying to destroy them. But based on the way our society is set up and our economies are run, unfortunately, that is the case. And so that really, I think that big challenge and trying to figure out our, how do we deal with our economy, and but also make sure that, you know, we have a planet to live on, was something that was planted during that trip. And even as I came back to Japan, I kept sort of thinking and kind of retooling my my bachelor's degree, and then going on to do my master's. And I've been kind of in this climate energy.
Was that because as you went through those, I guess, you know, the US has some absolutely stunning nature, that there was evidence of deterioration that you were already seeing, or was it just a very, very strong feeling that we need to preserve this and do everything possible? Was it the drive to preserve what we have at the moment, or was the seed planted perhaps because you already saw activities that were damaging that nature?
I was lucky enough to only see the beautiful parts of nature. I think I have a vivid imagination. So even as I was at the beach in Hawaii, I was thinking, well, I don't know when else I can come back and how long this is going to be here. And that was enough for me to really want to do something about it.
And when you say that, you know, the aim here was to bring together business plans in order to help preserve the environment, can you give us sort of an example of some of the thinking behind that?
Yeah, it was, for instance, in Hawaii, there was a beach with that was famous for its turtles, and they have a lot of visitors coming in. And so, you know, we're all students, so I don't really think we came in with proper business ideas, but it was basically thinking of ways of, you know, how do we preserve the tourism? How do we, you know, still ensure there's some revenue, but also making sure that it does stay as a place for turtles, and, you know, we can keep our pristine waters. And I guess as we were going through that, we started realizing that, well, there's also global warming, and it is affecting the kind of global ocean acidity levels and sort of other bigger factors that go beyond this beach itself, that the climate is changing. And having, you know, how do you ensure, you know, as a business that does rely on nature, that you can still sort of you can be resilient against this. And so I guess like slowly my mind sort of start going to like, okay, but what is driving climate change? And okay, it's the burning of fossil fuels, it's the economy. Yeah, so it was honestly a great kind of exercise, food for thought for all of us.
It sounds like there was an incredible amount of impact and stimulation packed in that 5 weeks that really sort of perhaps changed the direction of your life. You might have ended up in a career in biology or chemistry and went in a different connection. You made an interesting comment before when you said that the economy, I can't remember the exact words, but the economy is not set up in a way that is going to be conducive to maintaining that environment. And I'd like to just explore that a little bit more. When you say the economy is not set up that way, do you think it's a fundamental issue with the way that the economy of the world operates this way? Or is it an issue with a fundamental problem with the objectives of economic activity? In other words, you know, constantly striving for higher GDP, et cetera, et cetera. And some of the, if you like, KPIs and objectives that we put out for the economic activity. Is it the activity itself, or is it the direction that we push the activity in?
I think one of the most important things would be to have a carbon price. So essentially, you know, it's free, it's cheap to pollute, and it's expensive to try to reduce your emissions. And you know, there needs to be a mechanism that would sort of disincentivize pollution and encourage people to invest into clean technology. So because we currently don't have those mechanisms, where you know, different countries will have different carbon prices, and you know, there are different levels and they work kind of in different ways, but fundamentally, you know, you need a minimum carbon price of around $100 per ton CO2, and that is not really in place. So I think one, you know, it's a bit hard for me to kind of sort of make broader comments on growth and development, and I think it is a very tricky thing to comment on, especially as a lot of parts of the world still don't have access to energy, don't have access to comfortable living, or you know, electricity or food. And so kind of we do need to be mindful of those needs, and to make sure that you know, the kind of the benefits that we experience here in Japan through economic growth are shared equally. But I guess, yeah, specifically for kind of developed countries like Japan, I think there's a huge problem in that, you know, the cost of doing business is unregulated at the moment.
Oh, yeah, it's an absolutely fantastic answer to what is a very complex question. And the point you raised about making sure that we are not incentivizing, or that we're de-incentivizing the people to undertake activities that are harmful to the environment, I think is a really, really salient point. Is that only possible with policy, do you think?
I do think so. You know, we see a lot of voluntary initiatives kind of around the world, but it's not, you know, it's not really working. We are, you know, like hurtling towards this climate disaster. We're about to, even last year, we passed 1.5 degrees, and it's, you know, I think we've had enough time to sort of see if companies could figure it out themselves. I think Japan's climate regulations have also been largely voluntary, you know, with emission caps, the emission targets being set by the various industries. But you know, that said, our emissions do keep going up, and I do think that there needs to be a kind of a stick and carrot approach where, again, there need to be some regulations and kind of making sure that the responsibility is shared by all industries and companies.
What do you think are the key reasons that we're not on track for net zero?
So just going back to I think policy is very important. Making sure that there are proper regulations on emitters, making sure that there are economic mechanisms that incentivize investment in clean technologies. Kind of, I did mention the corporate influence on policy, but I do also think that public education is would be quite important. And unfortunately, I think the Japanese voters aren't demanding stronger climate action. But that is also something that would be a huge catalyst to policy. When I talk to people, I think the kind of common perception tends to be that, well, I buy, so I use my bag when I go grocery shopping, or I use my own bottle, or I recycle, and that is great. That is important. But kind of, even if your own consumption drops to zero, or at the end of the day, you still take transportation, or you will go to a supermarket, and all of these things do still emit CO2. Even the electricity they use to charge your laptop is not carbon free.
They're not carbon free.
So yeah, it's a huge systemic problem that requires policy, that requires massive change. And so I think demanding that from, whether you're a private consumer or whether you're a company is really important.
I think also you're fundamentally being in PR, fundamentally, people have a lot of trouble with imagining a dark future. And so people tend to look at the future and they are always far more optimistic than what the reality is likely to be. And so in PR and communications, we're often looking for creative ways in order to bring that future to a visualization that people can see. And there have been some interesting examples and experiments done with that, even with young kids in university who, if you use that technology to show them what they look like when they're getting old, it can show your face as they're getting old. Kids who have been exposed to that are a lot more likely to take out life insurance and enter pension plans than kids who haven't seen themselves at age 70 or age 80. It's really, really quite an interesting one. So, how we can sort of, I think, help people visualize the impacts of not achieving the targets is a perennial problem for. We visualize it now, right? We have what huge floods in Dubai, and we're having all 30 degree days in April in Tokyo. It's certainly the impacts of climate change, I think, are being felt more and more every year. But still, people, I think, have a very, very optimistic view that we will overcome those as the human race, and that the future will be a little bit brighter. So I think it still remains an issue there. How do you, talking about the issue of policy, and you've convinced me that without policy, that the achievement or poli without policy, encouraging people to or incentivizing people to take actions, particularly corporations that are going to be non-detrimental to the environment, is very, very difficult. When we look at policy, particularly in the globe today, there's a great differential between different regions, if you like. So the EU is very, very much, I guess, advanced in the way that they look at these and the way that they also have public education programs within the EU to heighten the awareness of the voters, so to speak. The other end of the spectrum, I think, would be the US now, where amongst the advanced countries, where you're beginning to see what you might even term a little bit of a pedal back around some of these issues. Japan's sort of in the middle, but as you say, you know, people think that as long as they separate their garbage and carry around their water bottles, then that may be enough. And there is a big issue around, obviously, energy in Japan, which I think influences this debate. And then you have obviously have a whole host of other countries that, particularly developing countries, that might have issues. And this disparity seems to have only grown or expanded over the past sort of decade or so. Is there a solution to that, do you think? We interviewed a lovely lady called Carol Fuchs, who works at the UK embassy, and she's working with other countries in Japan, other embassies, in sort of the alignment of policy. She's also the only person I've ever spoken to that's climbed Mount Everest, but an absolutely amazing work to sort of try and smooth out some of those differences that we're beginning to see between jurisdictions.
I would say maybe the first thing to kind of we would love to see countries do is pay attention to climate science. Because ultimately, we are dealing with a physical problem that is going to have physical impacts. And, you know, at the root of it all are kind of chemical, physical emissions. So making sure that the policies are kind of sticking to climate science and that are effective would be key. And then the other thing is that the proper climate policies can also spur industries and be a huge boost to kind of new employment, new technologies, and create leaders in the climate space. And I think in that sense, no country would disagree, whether it's US or China or Japan or Europe, everyone wants to see their industry succeed in this area. So I think in that sense, I am quite optimistic. Of course, it is then important to make, again, just going back to the science point of view, that we are promoting technologies that are actually viable and that will contribute to CO2 emissions. Even in the US, right, there is the IRA that is a huge boost to EVs and renewables, and it's kind of really spurring the rollout of clean technology. So I'm not quite sure. I don't think Japan should be relaxing just yet. It's definitely has a lot of competition. And then also for big multinational companies, they do need to operate in different regions. EU is a big market. I think they should still be aware of what is happening policy-wise in that region. And, they could even kind of use that as an example to try to kind of advocate for other more ambitious policies around the world that would sort of make their own operations easier. And we also see, for instance, the carbon border adjustment mechanism coming out. So it's the tax on CO2 emission import. So if an importer in the EU is bringing in a product like steel from a region, from another region, the mechanism would try to kind of put a tax adjustment to kind of sort of making sure that the importers in the EU are not being undercut. So I think those types of measures are also kind of having a positive ripple effect to other markets, and you know, companies are now hopefully this will act as an incentive to, you know, kind of for other nations to raise their domestic carbon pricing policies. Or if not, we already see companies going ahead with their internal carbon pricing mechanisms to try to sort of be ahead of the curve and make sure that they can sort of meet these changing regulations. So in that sense, of course, policy fragmentation is difficult, but I do also think that there is a lot of benefit to an economy to have strong, clean energy and ambitious climate policies.
Climate science is I was watching I think it was a TV news program or over the weekend, and there was a commentator on there talking about the fact that she'd visited a school, and it was a primary school or an elementary school, as called in the US, and students were going through SDGs education, and she was so absolutely amazed at some of the statements, and you know, the kids had moved from a dynamic of her generation where everyone wanted to have a new uniform and the best, cleanest, sort of nice uniform, whereas the kids that had gone through this SDG training program were much more into getting a secondhand uniform, because they felt that that was more, as we're saying, Japanese kakkoi than having a brand new one, which is a major mind shift brought through very, very early education. But is there a need also, do you think, at a very, very elementary level to be educating or to introduce some form of education around climate science into the curriculum on a broad base within Japan? Because one of the things we have today, I can't remember who said it, but there's a saying that everyone is entitled to their own opinion, but you are not entitled to your own facts. However, often now there is a tendency for people to have their alternative facts or my truth. And I think that really indicates perhaps a departure from science or a departure from understanding of science. And I just wonder whether it is a call to embedding that science in the curriculum in a much more elementary way from an early stage.
Absolutely. I think that would be that is crucial to to dealing with climate change and to having informed society and making sure that our kids grow up and they kind of try to apply themselves to, you know, come up with solutions to deal with this problem. So yes, absolutely. I think that's very necessary.
Is the problem with the science, or the issue with science today, that it's too difficult for people to understand, or is it just the issue that everyone has a different interpretation? I get the sense that, you know, some of the pushback that we're seeing in the United States is what we would call in my profession the noisy minority, and that in fact, when you look at, you know, under the surface, that companies are still relatively committed to doing this. There are still a lot of investment going into new technologies, a lot of investment going into what we can call GX activities. But there seems to be a perception that's been created perhaps by a noisy minority that there's a quite a significant pedal back going on around this issue. And that needs to be contained before it begins to grow in momentum. But it can only be counterbalanced by science. But is the science perhaps too difficult to understand, or it's just not being disseminated in the right way or amplified in the right way? What do you think are any potential issues there?
So on the US so-called anti-ESG movement, we actually our US team did a very interesting study where we traced kind of the narratives, and we found out that has been pushed by a very small group of fossil
Wow.
fuel groups. So kind of I believe the Coal Association has virtually drafted the full kind of statement that was then picked up by legislators and some of these media groups. It is a lot of noise, but it's not a mainstream view. It is unfortunate now, of course, that there have been some lawsuits and companies, and it do seem to be quite cautious of how they communicate around ESG. But what we see is that it's mostly kind of they're adjusting their public communications, so maybe dropping the three letters ESG, but everything that it stands for, being socially responsible, ensuring that your kind of environmental standards are still met, is still good for business. So companies are not walking away from those fundamental metrics. And again, especially for international companies, they have to still comply with EU regulations, with Japanese regulations. And we don't see any indication that kind of the fundamentals are changing. It's really kind of the adjusting the PR and So
Yeah, cool. Is that piece of research done by US people available on the website or
yes, it's on InfluenceMap's page, and
Oh,
all of our
good.
research is free. It's open source. You just need to make one account, and then you can look at
Excellent.
all of
I'd
our
like to
content.
share that within my own organization. Very, really interesting point. So coming to Japan. We've already talked a little bit about the fact that Japan's perhaps could be doing more in terms of policy around climate change. What are some of the areas do you think particularly that more could be done on?
Yes, the biggest one would probably be ending coal use in power generation. That is a key first step. Increasing renewables, and maybe setting a more kind of stringent carbon price. So yeah, maybe you have to sort of go into a bit more details on those. So the current Japan's current 2030 target for coal is it's 2 times higher than what IPCC is recommending for 2030. So one kind of big thing that we always try to emphasize is that it's not net zero by 2050. We don't really have until 2050 to wait to change our power sector, to change our cars. To meet that target, we actually need to be hitting all these milestones along the way. And 2030 is a really important, crucial moment where we need to reduce emissions by half. Well, I guess Japan's commitment is 46%, with a goal of trying to reach 50%. And it is a very difficult target. It is, no one is denying that, but so in order to do that, we can't be investing in, new gas and power generation. We need to be creating plans for how do we end coal, kind of, and make sure that we are hitting these milestones. Kind of, I think ammonia co-firing has been now presented as an alternative to this problem. The issue with that is the technology is still not commercialized. So I think when you look at roadmaps, the kind of in theory, when you burn 100% ammonia, it does not emit CO2. That is true. But to get to that 100% stage, companies are now blending kind of different shares of ammonia and trying to sort of increase the share of ammonia and to decrease coal. But that, you know, experiment is currently, I think, set for 2050. So that means that the expectation is that coal will still be in our electricity generation until that time. And then the other problem is with how ammonia is produced. So it currently, most of hydrogen and ammonia around the world is made from fossil fuels. There are some pilot projects that are trying to capture this carbon and store it. Those are still pilot projects. Mostly, kind of, this production is very emissions intensive. And then Japan is also planning to produce it all overseas. So then there's the shipping kind of emissions and figuring out the logistics and supply chains. And kind of a lot of, yeah, so it's a very complicated process. It's a very expensive process too. So it is very concerning that kind of this technology, so coal power generation should be phased out immediately. I think most of G7 countries, except for Japan, were ready to commit to this, but that hasn't happened yet. And instead, it's trying to use these alternative technologies that aren't, you know, haven't been commercialized yet. That is very concerning. And then alternatively, it's a similar story with natural gas as well. So LNG is a fossil fuel, and depending on how it's produced and how it's brought to Japan, there could be associated methane emissions and supply chain emissions that could make it as polluting as coal in some cases. So again, kind of relying on this technology as their pathway to net zero it goes against climate science.
I don't want to get involved in the anti-nuclear, pro-nuclear debate, but would Japan starting up its reactors alleviate the reliance on coal and coal substitute products?
Yes, probably. Yeah. It is a CO2 neutral energy source. But of course, it does have it comes with a lot of risk. And kind of, so interestingly, the IPCC that kind of we refer to for all our benchmarks also looks at the feasibility of a technology, and that includes social acceptance, that includes sort of the political feasibility and cost as well. So from that standpoint, nuclear does have a role to play in different IPCC studies, but because of these challenges, it doesn't seem to be like the main energy source. Primary electricity, like the vast majority of electricity should come from renewables. And in certain regions where it's acceptable, nuclear could play a role in supporting the kind of renewables. So I guess our view is that yes, nuclear could, and of course it could maybe offset coal use in Japan, but it does need to be approached with caution, and there have been historically issues with cost, issues with acceptance, and then of course long-term storage. So yeah, so that's our view.
So the point you made about coal still being within the agenda in 2050 is a very salient point that I hadn't picked up on before with those technologies. So turning now to what are some of the, without sort of mentioning specific names, I guess, what are some of the ways that you see Japanese companies trying to influence the policy direction? We talked earlier about the fact that in Asia, you don't really have the overt lobbying that you see very often in some jurisdictions.
Yes, but it still happens. And yeah, maybe I can go back to the UN definition, a list of activities that are constituted as policy influencing. So, of course, directly talking to policymakers and, you know, kind of these direct meetings are an example of lobbying, but also using media to influence the public discourse. So even press releases, kind of paid advertisements, this is also lobbying. Things that kind of the CEOs or representatives of companies say in public, if they say something that is policy relevant, that is also a form of lobbying, because you know, that then gets carried to the politicians, or that again influences how the public perceives a certain form of policy. And of course, industry associations or institutes or PR agencies, any sort of third party group that your company is paying to have an impact on policy, that is also a form of lobbying. So at InfluenceMap, we look at public statements, so anything that we can find in the open, and we have a way of kind of cataloging it by data source and then also by a policy issue. So most examples, so the most preferred, I guess, way of influencing for Japanese companies is through industry groups. So the companies directly will oftentimes not have too much out there that is policy relevant. So in terms of what we do recommend, so among all of these different ways, we have weightings. So we apply different kind of importance weightings. So, you know, if you think about it, something that you put on Twitter is going to have less example than when your CEO goes and talks to the prime minister. Of course, the most direct and important impactful way would be for the company to join a government committee and to try to sort of get direct face-to-face meetings with policymakers and politicians. If they can't do that, so we understand that, you know, getting selected for these things can be a bit difficult, the next thing a company could do would be to use the voice of their CEO. And actually, that is something, so we also have a guide on, I think, 5 steps, what a company can do to become a corporate leader in policy engagement. And it starts with the top. So the CEO and the board level, the C-suite executives, need to understand the strategic importance of policy engagement and how it can be played to the company's advantage. Of course, there are a lot of risks. So kind of, you know, making sure that your company is not lobbying negatively or against your own strategies is very important. So again, that is a C-suite issue that should be governed to that level. But also it can be used as a very powerful tool. For instance, if you want to procure renewables for your business, you know, when you're operating in a country that has a strong renewable policy strategy, is going to be good for you. So again, just kind of making sure that that understanding at the very top of the company is there, and then setting the right policies, making sure that your kind of divisions within your company are aware of the strategy, are in line and kind of doing their functions is critical. And yeah, in terms of what we score, kind of repeated messages, particularly from high-ups at the company, is very impactful. And that's what we see, for instance, coming from the so-called oppositional voices. So in Japan, it's steel, transport, utilities, some oil and gas companies, oil supply chain companies. Kind of in other countries, yeah, it is the oil and gas majors. So they repeat the same messages over and over and over. It comes from, you know, the high up of the company, but also different forums and in different kind of media outlets and in different conferences and using their industry associations. I guess my advice to the positive companies that are trying to learn is to kind of look at how it's done behind those groups and trying to adopt the same tactics.
Mm.
You know, kind of sign-on letters, so I think are kind of a popular method right now. That is good. That is a good first step. But that needs to be amplified, and that message needs to be repeated over and over and over from different outlets.
The tactics you're describing there for the dissemination of negative information are really sort of quite basic PR tactics. You know, define what your messages are, repeat them over and over again in different formats. I think my last company had done research and said that the average person needs to hear the same information 8 to 10 times over different platforms before they believe it. And so that repetition process in different forums is really, really quite critical. But as you say, perhaps those companies who are at the other end of the spectrum can also learn from those tactics in a way to get out the good news more effectively. Just in the time we've got remaining, what about the future? We've got about 5 minutes left, and we always ask the question at the end. Where do you think you will be in 5 years? Where will InfluenceMap be in 5 years? And where do you think this issue will or should be in 5 years?
Yeah, I hope that in 5 years, I won't really have to explain what policy influencing will be.
Good objective.
I hope that it will be kind of, you know, basic background understanding. I hope that, we won't have to, or I guess, we'll be discussing with more and more positive companies about kind of how do we make their influencing more strategic and impactful. Because as I mentioned before, you know, having more renewables or kind of these climate policies are, they make sense. They're good for business. They're good for the country. I do like to stay optimistic and kind of think that, you know, common sense policies and practices will prevail. I guess in that sense, I do hope that the work that InfluenceMap does won't be needed in 5 years. We're basically a watchdog, kind of trying to call out, you know, kind of provide information on the negative practices, and then also teaching the good companies how to do their, how to amplify their lobbying. That is my goal.
I love the concept behind InfluenceMap. So perhaps there is a way to extend constant striving to bring greater transparency to some issues that perhaps are not as transparent as they are. I'm sure there'd be other areas where that sort of expertise that you've gained in the area of climate can also be applied to. I think I was thinking the other day that if I look back from the 1990s, in other words, pre-internet days, probably the single biggest change that we have seen in society is the degree of transparency and the way that people demand transparency or even expect transparency these days. They've come so used to it. And so that works both in the positive and the negative way. But obviously there are still many, many areas of our society and our economy where transparency is not perhaps up to the levels that people deserve or societies deserve to have that. So The work that InfluenceMap does in bringing about that transparency is very laudable, and I congratulate you for it, and hope that you don't disappear in 5 years and that you just go on to bigger and better things, because I'm sure there are many, many other issues to tackle. Monica, this has been an absolutely fantastic discussion. Certainly, you've educated me on a number of points and convinced me on a number of points. And I thank you very, very much for a really, really interesting dialogue today.
And thank you very much, Ross, and to the Japan Times for this discussion.
I just would like to mention that we do have a live roundtable event that will be happening on May 23rd, this Thursday, which will be in person. With that being said, I hope that the viewers have enjoyed this roundtable talk. And until next time, thank you all.